Welcome back. This is Professor Rood, and this is video 4 of Chapter 11 Earthquakes. We were talking about different types of destruction caused by earthquakes. Let's continue with our discussion. A seiche is the rhythmic sloshing of water in a basin, like a lake or a reservoir. And this can be quite dangerous for small boats and actually can cause the water to overflow the dams of reservoirs. Landslides and ground subsidence are additional destruction that can occur. Fires, when gas and electrical lines are destroyed. The very large 1964 Good Friday earthquake in Alaska, there was a landslide in an area called Turnagain Heights. There happened to be a clay layer that was very weak. And when things began to shake, everything just slid along this weak clay called the Bootlegger Cove clay. And in less than 5 minutes, 200 meters of the bluff area had been destroyed. And this is showing again the destruction here. Most of us have become quite aware of tsunamis. These are a series of large ocean waves produced generally when a large earthquake occurs. It doesn't have to be an earthquake. They can travel across out in the open ocean at 800 kilometers per hour, but are only a meter high with wavelengths larger than 700 meters. When the wave gets nearer to shore and starts dragging on the ocean floor, the water piles up and can exceed 30 meters in height. However, the velocity of the wave does decrease at that point. Megathrust earthquakes are oftentimes responsible for large tsunamis. Here is a visual of a subducting slab and the overriding plate. So the fault has been locked here. And you get this bulge, you get this deformation of the plate. And when it snaps and breaks loose, you get a megathrust earthquake. A tsunami can then be generated, and out in the open waters, it travels at a high rate of speed and not a great amplitude. When you come near a land, then the tsunami speed decreases and the height of the wave increases and can cause devastation. An extremely devastating tsunami occurred in 2004 in Indonesia. It was a magnitude 9.1 earthquake and killed 230,000 people. In 2011, the Japanese tsunami struck the coast and caused actually their nuclear power plant to melt. The greatest damage from the Japanese earthquake was from the tsunami, not from the ground shaking, and approximately 16,000 people died from that earthquake. This is a picture of the 2004 Indonesian tsunami coming onto shore. This is an image of the 2011 tsunami damage in Japan. There is a tsunami warning system in the Pacific Ocean that was initiated, and warnings are issued when large earthquakes occur. There are a series of deep water buoys in the Pacific Ocean to detect energy released by earthquakes, as well as tidal gauges to measure sea level rise and fall so that appropriate warnings can be placed. This diagram shows if an earthquake occurred at the Aleutian Islands, it would take a very large earthquake and a tsunami occurred, it would take about 5 hours to reach Honolulu. If a large earthquake occurred in New Guinea, it would be about 10 hours for the tsunami to reach Honolulu, and South America, about 12 hours. Most of our earthquakes do occur in the Ring of Fire and along the Pacific Plate. And once again, it's these megathrust faults along convergent plate boundaries that are notorious for producing very large earthquakes and the potential for tsunamis. Another area where large earthquakes occur is the Alpine Himalayan belt. Generally, divergent plate boundaries are not associated with large earthquakes, and transform faults may have large earthquakes, but they tend to be cyclical in nature. Just look at the number of earthquakes along a ring of fire here. And then here's the Alpine Himalayan belt. When you think of earthquakes in the United States, you may just think that they occur in California and west of the Rockies. However, there were six major earthquakes that occurred in the past that had magnitudes of 7.5, 7.3, and 7.8. And they were centered near the Mississippi River Valley. In particular, these are along in the New Madrid Fault Zone. And they occurred in the winter of 1811 and 1812. On August 31st, 1886, Charleston, South Carolina was the greatest historical earthquake in the eastern United States. So there are major faults in the central and eastern parts of the United States. Here's a list of 14 historic earthquakes, their dates, intensities, magnitudes, and then some general information. And here they're plotted up on the map. So there are some areas east of the Rockies that are known for fairly large earthquakes or moderate-sized earthquakes. This shows damage in 1886 in the South Carolina earthquake. So, can we predict an earthquake? Well, not really, not in the short term anyway. We try to. What we look at in trying to predict an earthquake in the short term is we look at what are called precursors. For instance, if the ground elevation changes, the strain in the rock changes, groundwater levels can change, the increase in the number of foreshocks can occur. These all are precursors, potential precursors that may indicate an earthquake is going to occur. Overall, though, not very successful in the short range. So generally, short range prediction not feasible at this time. Long range forecasts do have potential. And what we look at with long range is the probability of a certain size earthquake occurring in a certain amount of time. So long range, we're talking 30 to 100 years or more. And our long range forecasts are very useful for building codes, building dams, roadways, etc. What we look at is the cyclic nature of earthquakes. Many large faults break in a definite pattern every so many years and produce earthquakes of roughly the same magnitude at similar intervals. If there is a seismic gap, these are tectonically quiet zones along a fault, and strain is building up. This may be an area that is ready to break and create an earthquake. And the strain in those rocks can be estimated using the rate of plate motion. Also, we can study ancient earthquakes. That's called paleoseismology. We can dig trenches along a fault zone and study the area for when earthquakes have occurred in the past. We can look for those sand or mud volcanoes, offset sedimentary rock layers. Looking at a seismic gap, here we're looking at Indonesia, and in this region, it has been tectonically quiet. So the potential for a large earthquake because of the subducting slab beneath Indonesia is generally thought to be fairly high. You can see earthquakes in the past, in 2004, 2005. These are very large earthquakes. These are great earthquakes, 9.2, 8.6, 8.4, 7.9. Once again, this is a megathrust. Those are what produce the largest earthquakes generally. Here we're looking at an area where they're looking at ancient earthquakes, the science of paleoseismology. So in this first diagram, this is prior to faulting. And then you get a displacement after earthquake one, erosion. Then they've identified earthquake two, erosion, earthquake three, and then the modern configuration. So they can go back and track previous earthquakes. The questions at the end of this chapter will supplement this lecture, and I highly encourage you to take a look at them and complete them. This concludes Chapter 11 lectures on earthquakes.